Yeah, essentially my name is Darcy Clark. If you guys have checked out anything, my talk was TBD up until about 2 days ago, which I apologize to Berman. I had my talk ready. I'm just really bad at pull requests, and I was just like, nah, not gonna do this. A little bit about me to get started. I do have 100 slides. I'm gonna go through these so fast, don't worry. I'm a UX developer, designer. I also call myself an advocate, user experience advocate. Essentially, if you were in Jen Meyer's talk that was in here this morning as well, she talked about unicorns. I like to call myself a unicorn every now and then. I just look at problems holistically. So that means that, you know, I really think about designers, I think developers and their problems they're facing, as well as sort of business and strategy. And the minute that you start taking all those into account when you're solving problems, I think that you are essentially doing a way better job and you're able to communicate with the team that much better. So I'm based in Toronto, as I said before. So the frigid north, if anybody from Canada? No? No Canadians? You guys all from Charlotte? Yeah? Two people? Three people? Lots of expats. So yeah, it's cold up there sometimes. It's actually pretty nice right now. You can follow me at GitHub at Darcy Clark, which is pretty cool. You can follow me on Twitter at Darcy, right? Right? Pretty cool. My first name, right? You guys are stoked about that? Mr. Darcy, anyone? I've never seen Pride and Prejudice, but apparently that guy's a jerk, so I'm not like that guy. But this is like sort of a blessing and a curse to have your first name as a Twitter handle, yeah? You know, I get like people like hanging out my house alone. This is kind of creepy, right? Like, what? I got this the other day. I was like, yeah, this tween should not be in my apartment right now. Or things like this where I'm into hip hop, right? I don't like techno. This is terrible. This is crazy. This is not me. I'm not teaching kids to like techno. And this one's very direct. This is like they're starting to get very aggressive with their tweets. So I mean, this is not me. I hope I'm not, unless everybody thinks I'm Mr. Darcy, this jerk, right? Yeah, this was, and this got a favorite and a retweet from one of my friends. Do you guys see that? That's terrible. Some work that you guys may or may not know me by. Anybody like WordPress? Know WordPress at all? I co-founded a company called Themify. It's a commercial WordPress theme company, about 4 years ago. My business partner is still running it today. I hate PHP and WordPress, so don't talk to me about WordPress. I did it for a number of years. Worked on really cool stuff, theme frameworks, which got really popular. So you may or may not know them. You may or may not be using a Themify theme. I've worked with a number of digital agencies across the globe, including Toronto, New York. I actually worked with Anton and Irene, if you guys saw the UX and design talk that they did yesterday at Fantasy Interactive for about a year in New York. So have worked with a lot of cool designers, developers. Also worked with a lot of big brands, Google, Microsoft, as a contractor, as well as with a bunch of those agencies. And I've worked on a lot of open source projects. So I've helped out for about a year and a half, helped out the jQuery team. I've done my own projects. Has anybody heard of the front-end developer interview questions? Yeah, one Dan, get out of here. If I know you by first name, that's not a good thing. These are amazing. If there's one thing that you get away from this talk, which has nothing to do with video, it's go check out the front-end developer interview questions. Google uses this document, essentially to help vet potential candidates. I know a lot of friends that use it as a good tool to keep themselves up to date with what employers are looking for. It's been starred about 7,000 times on GitHub, translated to 25 different languages. So like people all over the world are using this, and it's just a great tool to sort of test your knowledge and your abilities. I also have sort of a collective started in Toronto. Me and two other developers are working together to essentially band together and tackle some open source projects. The major one is a project I started about a year and a half ago called DSS, and it's not Darcy style sheets. It's not. although that would be wicked if it was. It's documented style sheets, very similar to KSS, if you guys have ever heard that. It's all written in Node. It's really cool. If you're into style guides, palettes, that kind of stuff, this helps automatically generate that for you based on your comment blocks in your CSS, your SAS, your stylus. So it's a really cool tool. And that was also being part of the focus, or being part of my focus for the past year and a half. So my last 12 months have looked a little bit like this. If there's anything on this list that you really like or you love and you want to talk to me about it after this talk, feel free. I'm into documentation, server-side rendering, which is a really cool problem, responsive images, build tools, and of course video, which I'm going to be talking about today. But again, if you see anything here and it's a passion of yours, come up to me afterwards and we can talk about that. So what we'll be covering sort of in this talk is a little history on video, digital video, which is kind of fun, but also how to manipulate that video, what people are doing right now to manipulate and do some cool things with it, some really cool interactive experiences. Again, I'm going to show you guys lots of demos. I'm hoping to get you inspired. If I can make you laugh, right, and dance around here, and I don't know, whatever's going to essentially make you guys walking away from here, being like, I want to talk to that guy later, have a beer with him, go party with him, that's cool. And we're going to talk about encoders and decoders, which is probably the coolest, if you're into JavaScript, it's the coolest thing that you're going to learn today or hear about today, and the future of encoders and decoders in JavaScript with video. And then we're going to touch a little bit on DRM and the EME spec, which is kind of the dry crap that if we don't get to it and you guys are starving, I'll just be like, here's some links. So the history, essentially, I break it out into three areas: codecs, containers, and playback for video. Back in 1986, who was born before this? Yeah, I wasn't. Now I've just told you how old I am. So I was born in 1987, so a year after Sony released Sony released the D1. It was the first ever digital video recording format. And look how many minutes of video it stored. 94. Literally. There's no way that Lord of the Rings could fit on 94 minutes of video. That's crazy. Unfortunately, the format was uncompressed, right? So that was probably the biggest downfall. It was pretty large to store anything with this D1. 2 years later, though, they worked with a company called Ampex to release D2, right, next version. And they offered a couple of things which were really cool: simultaneous playback, composite video over component, which was really cool, so you could do some like overlay type stuff. Unfortunately, this format was still uncompressed, which is an issue, a big issue. So that same year, though, something else was released, which we should all sort of have an understanding of, or it should look a little familiar. H.264 was released, and it was the first of a suite, right? We all know H.264, right? It's the essentially MP4 uses that codec. It finally was the first video format codec to use compression, which is really important, right? And if you're ever talking to somebody or you hear the word codec, you can sort of think of it like this. It's essentially the two words thrown together, coder and decoder. I like to think of compression and decompression. So it's the algorithm that essentially will make a file nice and small and also then be able to read it afterwards, right? So that's cool. So as far as video playback, though, 1991 to 2007, who's been developing since 1991? No? You're awesome. Yeah, good for you guys. You remember, this is a long time ago. I think I started in 2002 and I was still dealing with like crap that, as far as video, there was no good solutions for video playback on the web. So playback in 1991, we had something called QuickTime. QuickTime was around. This was not the interface that shipped. I had a hard time finding the QuickTime original interface. And of course, you had to get a prompt to download this. This is awesome, right? Like having to be prompted to download something locally. Then in 1995, 4 years later, we got RealPlayer. Who had this, right? Real One Player? Yeah. Real One Player was the best, man. They thought it was a really good idea to put a browser in Real One Player, right? Imagine having to debug this. What were the developer tools for Real One Player? Does anybody know? There weren't any, right? Crazy. So Real One Player came out. Again, we had more prompts. Again, asking the user a lot to essentially download something to play back video. 1996, so 2 years later, we got everybody's favorite, Flash, video player, right, and format. And of course, we got more of these prompts. You know, click on this crazy agreement, which, you know, we're going to install some spamware or something onto your computer. Install now. 1997, my favorite video player was released. Can anybody guess what it was? No? Anybody? VLC? No. No. That was it. I didn't hear it, man. That's cool. 1997, Winamp, yo. You don't remember Winamp, right? You don't remember this Winamp. You remember this Winamp, right? This was the cool one, right? You'd be playing StarCraft, and you'd like tell your bot to change songs, or you'd be like, you know, sweet, had lots of command line interfaces. It was, again, there we go. The aftermath, unfortunately, of all these different players, all these different implementations was a lot of fragmentation, right? So we had all these different file formats, we had all these different video playback tools. So we got, you know, AVI, WMV. I did not talk about Windows Media Player for a specific reason, because I hate it. But we got the FLV format. So like, there's a ton of fragmentation starting to happen in the digital video space. That said, 2007, February 28th, it's this big epic moment in just on the cusp of HTML5 spec really being adopted by a lot of browsers. Opera proposes the video element, right? They're so cool, they implement it the same day into Opera. Like a boss, right? Opera, good for you, although you're kind of falling behind. Unfortunately, 7 years later, if we go and look at, can I use, what's Opera Mini doing to us, right? It's the only one that doesn't support the video element. What happened to Opera, right? Essentially just blink now. But essentially the video element is supported everywhere. This is a quick example of if you've ever implemented a piece of video since HTML5 spec has come out and been adopted, you've done something like this, right? You've implemented maybe a few different formats, so you have the widest browser coverage. You've got MP4 there, WebM, OOG, or OOG format, or Theora format for older Firefox versions. And then the final fallback, these are essentially fallbacks. Final fallback there is just a link. So this would be shown on like IE8. And of course, yeah, explosions, right? And that's what it looks like. So that's pretty sweet. And this is everywhere now. We have a consistent playback medium for the web for video. And it's the video element. So that pretty much, you know, revolutionized video on the web. So unfortunately, if you still have to worry about those older browsers that don't exactly have support for all the lovely HTML5 awesomeness, you can use something called the Media Element Library, if you've ever seen this. It's well-touted. Paul Irish, Chris Coyer, who's here. Not in this room. I'm going to give him flack for that later. He also touts this. Essentially, their support is awesome. It's wide-ranging. They have a bunch of fallbacks with Flash, Silverlight, and native implementations to essentially give you the widest coverage for video online if you need to be supporting older browsers or, for some reason, Opera Mini. So that's sort of like the history of where we have come from with a video. I want to look at some like cool demos with you guys. And as far as like manipulation of video, I want to show you some stuff. So the basic sort of way to manipulate any kind of video is to like throw it into either a Canvas object or a WebGL instance. And so right here I have a quick demo. Let's see if I can remember my commands. Oh yeah, that's gonna mess things up. So here, let's zoom in on things so it's like way easier for you to see. Can I do this Option or Control? There we go. Control in, Control out. Cool, so I got like wrap HTML class. But essentially I have a video element and I have a canvas object. And what I'm doing is I'm adding a little bit jQuery down here to get the instances of those two elements and to essentially stream the video into the canvas object. So if we go back to this and we start playing this video, it essentially is just streaming the video from there, from that video element, right into the canvas object. So this is the most basic, there's a little set interval that essentially draws each frame into the canvas element. And this is where you can start to actually manipulate video. And you can have this sort of running off screen. So there's some really cool examples of utilizing Canvas essentially as a manipulation tool. Remy Sharp has a number of really interesting HTML5 demos. If you go to his website, hflodemos.com, essentially, we can even, he's got like a little color changer here, which essentially just manipulates the video data's like RGB values and can essentially set the like chroma. That's pretty sweet. So that's him and his little kid. We can actually allow, so we got hardware API access, right? So I'm like red right now, I'm blue, green. It's pretty sweet. So this is the get user media spec to actually grab the camera. This camera stream, throw it into a canvas object, and he's just doing some manipulation with color. So, I also want to show you one of my other favorite examples of essentially manipulating video in a canvas object. If we're going back here in time, history is repeating itself. There we go. So there's this canvas explosion demo that came out when HTML5 video player was essentially adopted by everybody. There's a bunch of open source projects that sort of blew up for open source video. And this basically this Bugs Bunny-esque movie was put together, again, all in the open source, which was really cool. But this is just a canvas element. And so once I start clicking around, you can actually see that they use some physics and again, some like just like touch positioning to figure out how to basically break apart this canvas element and basically look like it's exploding. And then you can see all the little pieces are still running the video inside of them, which is really cool, right? Sweet, right? We're starting to get excited about what you're gonna do with this stuff, because I am. No? You guys are a lively bunch today. I gotta step up my game here. So, okay, Canvas is kinda cool. I'm sure you've heard about it. I'm sure you've done something, maybe you've drawn an image into it, and now you can do a simple, basically draw video frames into the canvas. WebGL filters are a little bit more advanced. And they have way cooler effects. So that's me. Sweet. So this is another great example. A guy from Japan actually created like a little demo of a number of filters. So he's got some simple ones here. So you can basically tile. This is essentially using WebGL filters. You can do zoom, which is really cool. This is all happening if I actually play. So it's going to take a while to load because I'm doing some crazy stuff. But it's essentially adding this WebGL filter to the video in real time, right? So I can actually change the how much the effect is happening on the video, which is really interesting, right? So there's like this blur effect that you can add. It's like a brightness. So you can again, changing like color data, and basically affecting how the video is showing up. You can go monochrome, you can go like black and white completely. Of course, it's some anime video, right? That's the example we're using. But that's really cool. But even cooler than that, 3JS. If you guys have ever looked at 3JS and materials in 3JS. So 3D now we're dealing with. WebGL 3D video, streaming video into a 3JS instance or environment. So these are a ton of blocks, right? This is just a demo of a video. Let's see if we can get it to refresh here. Of a video that's being streamed into like a 3JS environment, and it's being mapped over all these blocks. You can see that they're being broken apart.
What brings you to the land of the gatekeepers?
So this is another, this demo is showing a video, another video that was made in the open source by like a Blender. If you've ever done any 3D, Blender is like a free open source 3D tool similar to like Maya. You can see they start to come together and you start to see the full picture. And there's the video all together. They're doing some like color manipulation. It's really interesting. The logo, sweet, right? So that's wicked. So that's materials WebGL with video. But what's really cool and what you're probably going to be able to sell all your clients on is face detection, right? Right? You guys definitely need that if you're working at Facebook, right? if you're working at Facebook. So I'm going to allow this. So we got some face substitution demos here. Average face, I appreciate that. This is actually a setting, but I thought this was like a little joke by the guy who made this demo. He's like, average face. As soon as they put in their face in the camera, they're gonna see the average face, right? It's gonna be your face. It's like a mirror, right? Average face. No, but I wanna be a little bit more like Kim. And so it can start to line up, taking video from my camera, start to line up and figure out where you know, my eyes are, and there's some facial recognition on the fly with the video. And if we start here, and oh, hey, yeah, it's pretty good, right? Or I could maybe go, I think Bieber is too close to what I actually look or like, right? So the queen, like, looks like she has a beard now, so it's kind of fun, right? But again, this is using a live stream. Oh my goodness. This is not, that is not, that looks like Sean Bean, not the Queen. So that's pretty cool, right? So you're taking a stream, like a stream from the camera, throwing it into essentially a canvas object there, doing some on the fly, using an algorithm to do facial recognition and then mapping. In that case, that was actually WebGL, not Canvas, sorry. And then mapping that onto those coordinates, right, onto those paths. So going further, so that was some manipulation of video and using WebGL and Canvas. A lot of that stuff requires some good understanding of JavaScript, and this next stuff will too. But there's some cool demos that I want to show you guys. Real-time color histogram. Zoom out here. What this does is essentially, again, we're just streaming a video, but we're looking at the color data. And here they're basically just saying, map the color data, whatever is the strongest or the most widely used colors in each frame, map that back to this like 3D object. If I refresh, then maybe it'll work. What's going on here? What you doing to me? Maybe I have my link wrong? Central Labs, example. Histogram. Oh, no. Now we're going into the future. Face detection. Okay, well, it was essentially, it maps the colors. There we go. It would map the colors into that 3D space, so it was a 3JS instance. And it would basically show you what was the most predominant colors in each frame and would continue to update as the video would play, right? Who likes Skype? Everybody uses Skype. Who hates paying for like unuseless chat programs like Skype? Yeah, yeah? Well, there's free chat rooms. And I did this demo with a bunch of people in Las Vegas. They all had devices. And then I was like, I'm coming here and nobody's gonna have Wi-Fi. They're all gonna be looking at me, which I appreciate. Totally appreciate you guys having your attention on me. But I'm the only one that's gonna be able to join this sweet room, so I'm like talking to myself, right? It's good. But essentially, anybody can join this talkie.io. This website showcases WebRTC, so real-time communication. And it's, again, just grabbing, using the Get User Media API that I showed you in that initial Remy Sharp video where I changed the color. They're using that again to grab the camera stream, and then they're throwing that across the web, and if somebody else joined in on this, we would be talking together, but I don't think I have any friends that have any devices on them right now, which is okay. But there's a lot of cool projects out there to help you do this yourself. So if you want to actually get WebRTC going and doing sort of peer-to-peer stuff, especially video peer-to-peer, PeerJS, right? There's a JavaScript library for everything. PeerJS will help you basically get that done. They have a ton of examples and demos, basically exactly how to do that, how to set up simple video chat. You can walk through that guide. So, who has seen this demo? Anybody seen the Arcade Fire demo? Yeah? This thing is crazy. It's like they get free money from Google to make their videos every now and then. It's messed up. This is the demo that they did. They got like a film crew to go come up with this crazy concept, and they took a bunch of film, and they got some creative technologists to use video and HTML. It's extremely interactive. If I start playing, so you can see that as I move around my cursor, it's doing some effects in WebGL for the actual video that's streaming. If I push down, it makes that effect, I think it's just more transparent is what they're doing there. But if we go further in to the video, there's some really cool stuff that they've done. So they're tracking my mouse events. But they've essentially taken all the points that they've gathered from this video, and they're mapping it back using JavaScript and WebGL, so I can like essentially interact with this video. It's an extremely immersive experience, right? It's not just I'm sitting there watching a music video anymore. I'm actually like doing something, creating like almost art. Right? So there's a bunch of different effects that they've added, similar to the materials that we saw, wrapping video. This is a really cool, got some like Illuminati stuff going on, so different points of light, right? And now they're like, oh no, don't hurt me, and then like you're moving this around. And there's an orb. This always reminds me of like Donnie Darko. Anybody a fan of Donnie Darko? Yeah, it's like the orb. So, yeah. That's pretty cool. Like, that's probably one of the best examples of how people are merging, a video with like an interactive experience. Again, using the video element to stream this stuff or to stream video into like WebGL. Of course, everybody's seen this, right? You guys are all happy, right? Anybody? No, nobody's happy. Pharrell? For real? You haven't heard of Pharrell? Essentially, they did like this 24-hour video, and there's like all this cool UI, and it's like, oh sweet, I want to go to like scrub to like the 720, or like let's go see what Pharrell was doing at like 420. Actually, no, I won't see that. But really cool. Essentially, they're making this interactive experience utilizing video, JavaScript. And so you're like, how can I do this? How can I make something like Arcade Fire? Popcorn.js is a great library. If you haven't heard about it, it's amazing. It lets you basically tie video back to JavaScript events, right? So as you're going through keyframes, you can actually trigger JavaScript events to do something, right? It can show a link, it can animate in a div, it can swap out that that video itself. So here's an example on popcorn.js. So this is just their default video. You can see that as I'm playing, this is just a normal video element. but as it's playing, some stuff is changing over here. And it's actually just HTML.
PopcornJS is an HTML5 video framework that lets you bring the web into your videos. Let's try it.
I got a nicer voice than that guy. But he's now loading up Google Maps into that little video at a certain point, or into that little div at a certain point in the video, which is really cool, right? So it's all queued up, and if I reverse back, you know, or if I scrub through the timeline, it's re-queuing up those events, which is really awesome, right? And what's even better, it's because Mozilla, this is a project that Mozilla, some interns at a Toronto-based college, and actually Boku, a company based in Boston, they all worked on this originally. They actually made a nice little editor called Popcorn Maker. Right, so this is almost like similar to like an After Effects, right? And I can import any video. So I have like a Will It Blend Justin Bieber, which is pretty sweet. Right, this guy, you've all seen this guy, right? They're like, Will It Blend, dude? He's got like a wig on, so sweet. We're gonna take this video and quickly throw it in here, and we say get media. And so you can add, this works, PopcornJS works with like YouTube videos, Vimeo videos, it's awesome. So we're gonna say we're just gonna add this to the timeline, and then we can say, you know, we're gonna add a new layer, and in this layer we're gonna add an event, and it's gonna show some text. It's like, this dude is awesome. I'm gonna grab that, I'm actually gonna say that I need to make this like, text advanced, because you know color is advanced, and make it white. Cool. And I'm going to queue that up. You can like change where it actually gets queued up. If you start playing,
will it blend?
That is will it blend? Sweet, dude. And then a text shows up, right? So you can actually play. This is like a nice little editor that you can actually use to generate an experience that utilizes JavaScript and video together, right? An interactive experience. And essentially what it creates is just like a JSON object that maps back to those events. Sweet. Some really cool stuff. So if you guys saw the Bleeding Edge, this is sort of the future that I wanted to talk to you guys about. If you saw Scott's talk yesterday, he was talking, or his keynote, he was talking about how your browser is pretty much like a little, I guess like a virtual machine. Was he saying the browser was a virtual machine? It's very powerful either way. JavaScript is now doing a lot of things, maybe too much. Actually, not never too much. It's doing just enough. But I want to talk to you guys quickly. I think I have 10, 15 minutes. I'm going to push the 15-minute mark. About JavaScript video encoders. And this actually is really cool to me. And you guys might be going, what the heck is he talking about? JavaScript video encoders. Some guys, if anybody's ever used FFmpeg, if you're like a back-end developer, you've probably utilized this library for video manipulation, grabbing a screenshot out of a video, or converting videos from one format to another, you've definitely used FFmpeg. So a team that was working on a project for Knockout JS, I think last year, they created video converter.js. Essentially, they ported FFmpeg into JavaScript. This is some crazy stuff. So in your browser, you can convert video. You can grab a screen out of a video for, you know, a screenshot. It's some crazy stuff. It's slow, but it works. It's amazing. So here's a quick little app. If I can actually get it to run. It's gonna refresh, no? The app. Yes, really, about your page. There we go. Start here, please be patient. Yeah, it takes forever to load. The actual size of the JavaScript file, which is FFmpeg, is like 5 megs, I think. It's something crazy. They use like mscript, and I think, to convert it. So we can grab, let's say, a test. Oh, man. Test, is that gonna work? Sweet. And then we can, once it finally loads up the metadata, you can actually do some fun file conversion. This is just a little demo that they put up to actually show that this works in the browser. So it's originally this video that I'm loading up as an MP4. We can convert it to a GIF, a movie. We can actually, you know, flip it or do something other stuff that if you've utilized FFmpeg before, you'll know these kinds of commands. So vertical flip, we can start processing. It'll take forever. It starts to log in the console what it's doing. This is all happening on your client side. This is crazy, right? Doing all this video manipulation. And it'll generate a downloadable file once it's done. It's really cool. Unfortunately, it's slow and it's extremely memory intensive. This is sort of an experiment. This is what can be done in JavaScript, can be done in Node, right? On the server side, which it'll be a lot faster. As far as throwing it into your client or into the browser, it's not a very good idea. JavaScript video decoders. Again, you're like, what the heck are you talking about? You can actually decode. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of examples that I could find to actually support audio. A lot of people are doing just video. So the first one you might run into is a library called JSMPEG. MPEG-1 is a really old school format. Nobody uses MPEG, right? This is an example of how that works. Again, we just get a canvas element, and we're actually just going to stream frames into it. And what's actually happening here is that we're taking a video file, right? We're going to do like a AJAX request, grabbing a video file, and we're converting it on the fly, right? We're decoding it on the fly, and frame by frame, we're throwing that into the canvas object. Really cool, right? Really cool. This is all happening in JavaScript. You don't need a video, you don't need proprietary support in Firefox or Chrome or Safari to support your video format anymore. You just need JavaScript. This is the really powerful stuff that, you know, I consider it to be the future. Unfortunately, JSMPEG, it's got narrow file requirements. It's picky implementation. MPEG-1 is really poor. But then if you keep looking in and you dig in a little bit further, you'll actually find a library for WebM. So again, a lot of these are kind of experimental, but WebM is, if everybody knows, it's got great file compression. Some video files can get about 25% smaller than MP4. And this is what example of that code looks like. Again, it's a little bit different, but you're getting canvas elements. And you're essentially just pointing to a video file. And then if I refresh the page, there you go. It's kind of slow. But basically what this is doing, again, does a fetch for the video file. It doesn't care whether or not the browser supports WebM or not. And it's reading that file and on the fly decoding it and putting frames into the canvas. So really sweet. If anybody did any mobile development back in the day, or even like a year ago, and they're like, oh, nothing autoplays or loops in like iPhones in the browser, this is the problem I've been trying to solve for like the last 2 years. So unfortunately, performance for this decoder is about 23 frames per second on the desktop. You gotta imagine, this thing is reading a video file and decoding it and putting it into the canvas element, which is crazy. And on mobile, unfortunately, it's even worse. You get like less than 10 frames per second. So it's not quite there. It's you know, your browser isn't that powerful to be running this kind of stuff. If anybody's run into the APing format, it's kind of a funny format that came around a number of years ago. Firefox is the only one that ever supported it. You can imagine a GIF is pretty big. APing is a lossless animated GIF format. So imagine stacking a whole bunch of pings together. You can imagine how big the file size starts to get. That kind of sucks, but again, it gives you animation. And this is, again, a JavaScript library that reads APing form. Like, if you can generate an APing on your server side, you can actually read it. And you can do some, again, streaming to a canvas object and get around that the animation problems or the video problems that you might have faced on mobile. So unfortunately, the actual APing format is kind of bloated, and to actually generate files, it's kind of painful. So these are crappy solutions. This one is probably the neatest, and this is, if anybody's ever seen this before, it was a nice little library that the guy from Sublime Text wrote for himself. He wanted to show little code snippet demos. So what you can see on the left-hand side is a generated image that works a lot like video does, where it's got a large frame, and then it's got a whole bunch of delta, sort of like smaller sprite images packed in there. And what happens is that gets generated along with a JSON file, and those get put together, and it just goes through. It uses like a set timeout, the little JavaScript, and essentially maps those coordinates, those image coordinates back, and creates the animation that you see here on the right. And does anybody know where these images are from? These are images. This isn't like some glitch in my slides. Anybody guess? No guesses? This is from Apple.com. This is actually how Apple has beautiful animations, and they have great marketing materials. How are they getting their animations to work on their own devices that don't even support autoplay and loop on the video element, right? On mobile devices, on iPads, on iPhones. Well, they actually do something really tricky, really hacky. They essentially create these images, right, that essentially are like a video format where they have all these sprites that are squished together. They have a whole bunch of deltas. They have a crazy algorithm that makes these for them. And then they have a JSON file, right, with a bunch of coordinates that maps back, and they animate over that. And they can throttle the animation. They can throttle the frames per second. And they can use request animation frame and some really cool stuff. So that's how they actually get their animations to work, right? Who likes DVDs or videos at all, right? Has anybody heard of DVD.js? I'm going to tell you, you can run a DVD in JavaScript. How are you guys not jumping out of your seats right now? This is crazy. This guy who I met this past year, I cannot pronounce his name. I'm going to call him GCM. GCM works at Mozilla. I cannot. Does anybody know how to pronounce that correctly? Okay. So Marty works at Mozilla. He doesn't even work with like JavaScript like at all. And he's like, in my spare time, I really want to run my DVD files in the browser. In my spare time. Of course. Yeah, everybody wants to do that. So he created DVD.js, which essentially originally he was trying to have it so it would actually stream and do real-time conversion and real-time decoding, like I've been showing you everywhere else. DVD.js actually is a one-time conversion. It'll take a DVD file, it'll strip out everything and turn them all into, and basically it's also, it's like a conversion tool as well as a playback tool. And it'll strip out the IFO files, turn them into JSON, right? Makes sense. Chapters, so if you want to skip to a chapter, all your DVD, your menu titles, it's got WebVTT, you got more JSON, CSS. He literally takes the menu from a DVD file and recreates HTML, CSS, and JavaScript web page. It's amazing, right? And I'm going to quickly show you what that looks like. He's got a demo here of him playing a movie, a DVD, in, I think it's VLC. And then he's showing on the right-hand side, this is what gets generated from DVD.js, right? And it's the exact same. It's like he's got the menu titles. Everything's there, right? It's beautiful. It's crazy, right? And he converts the video file, I think, into a WebM from what it was originally. And so it's feature parity, right? You don't need VLC. You don't need to be locked into a proprietary Bluetooth format or something. JavaScript. It's JavaScript. It's sweet. Right? So he starts playing the video. He goes to a chapter. There you go. He shows on the right-hand side. You can skip to chapters, run everything in his browser. The future. So I just showed you a bunch of stuff, and you're like, this isn't even the future yet. Well, last year, what got me really excited about this topic and got me really excited about video in general, I saw a blog post called Today I Saw the Future. When you see that, you go, what did this person see, right? Brendan Eich, who's former CTO of Mozilla, wrote a blog post about this, and he said, Mozilla and Otoy deliver the power of native PC applications to web, unveil next generation JavaScript video codec for movies and cloud gaming. This was a blog post that like went into depth about a company that Otoy that was creating something called Orbix.js, which is utilizes the cloud and GPUs to do some really cool stuff. Essentially, do video to have a video codec that again will encode and decode video for you, and to do it with great performance. So the problem is with all the examples I was showing you, all the libraries I was showing you, performance is kind of an issue with once you get into a larger file size. So they specifically were working on this. And if you saw any of Mozilla's or Firefox demos in the last couple of years, they've been really pushing their WebGL stack, ASM.js, and they've been showing you like Unreal Engine running in Firefox, right? So this is working under that same thing. So what makes this interesting? Well, he's actually a board member, so of course he's gonna be like, check out this cool thing, right? Right? That makes it super interesting. Advisory board, yeah, of course. Of course I'm gonna write a blog post saying today I saw the future, right? You wanna boost their, stocks went through the roof that day, right? But actually, what makes Orbix.js, this new library, and this this idea of a JavaScript video codec, other than the fact that you're getting away from proprietary codecs like H.264, and you don't have people owning these things, is 25% better compression than H.264. That's crazy. Adaptive bitrate, I don't really understand. You can ask the AV guys. You totally get that, right? Adaptive, yeah, you're down. You're down with it. Better color depth, flexible, and of course, the biggest thing for me, it was open source, right? It's gonna be open source. Anything in JavaScript, nobody's gonna own it. You're not gonna have to worry about paying a license if you want to implement the JavaScript video player into your projects, into your apps. And you're like, what is going on, Darcy? You're blowing my mind right now. Yeah, I'm gonna show you a demo of basically a virtual machine running in your browser right now. So this is essentially, you're in Firefox, this demo was done in Firefox, and there's a video player. It looks like Windows Media Player, forgive them. But this is actually running like in a canvas, streaming. There's no default support for what's happening here. This is just JavaScript, right? So you can see he's scrubbing through and he's getting this is like looking through like a virtual box or something, like into the cloud, right? So they're offloading the horsepower, or they're offloading a lot of the work of actually having to do that encoding or that decoding of a video file to the cloud, which is really cool, and that's what that shows. Another example is they said that it was good for not just video codecs, a JavaScript video codec, but also for programs, apps, and gaming. Here's an example of them actually running, looks like, I think it's Photoshop or After Effects, and they're doing manipulation. It might be actually Maya or something like that. Yeah, it's a 3D program. And they're showing it native versus in the browser, which is kind of crazy, right? But there's more. Major studios are looking at Orbix.js as a solution to use video on demand watermarking, DRM free. Right, so they can actually use this. This is the biggest problem that we're probably gonna face in the next couple of years, is DRM's gonna creep into our lives. It's gonna creep into, it already is creeping into the W3C and spec work, which is kind of crazy. And the future headaches that we're gonna deal with are digital rights management as developers and this spec called the encrypted media extensions. Has anybody heard of that? How many people, raise your hand, have heard about EME spec? No? It's coming up. What handles this right now is if you have a proprietary video, if you have something that's like, oh, I've got my music in this video, or I work for, somebody that offers up training guides, you have to use Flash or Silverlight essentially to give yourself some sort of protection. You're being asked by your higher ups essentially to give them some sort of protection for video. Of course, there's a great website called Defective by Design, which kind of, this is DRM, that's how I feel about it. Who cares? I hate copyright, I'm open source. Of course it's being driven, DRM and all these decisions are being driven by all these people. Yeah, these lovely old school people that, they're doing such a good job right now. This is the day after the last episode of Game of Thrones came out. Can we just like look at that number right there? Cedars was 80,000 cedars, not leechers, on this one torrent for the last episode of Game of Thrones this past season. So they're doing a good job. DRM's doing its job, right? So might as well make everybody's life harder and continue to use it. The EME spec, the W3C, is putting together a spec that will hopefully get rid of, you know, flash and Silverlight for good. Unfortunately, it creates new black boxes that we don't really know what's going in them. You don't really know what's in the Flash Player plugin right now at this point. So if you're asking also, like I do, EME, what the heck? Go to HTML5Rocks. There's a great tutorial actually on how to even implement this. Again, it utilizes the video tag, but it essentially encrypts what's being streamed through that, which is kind of interesting. And of course, this spec, the EME spec, is actually being pushed through by the great company Netflix, right? Everybody loves Netflix. Give them 10 bucks a month and you don't watch a video, right? Not one of you has watched Netflix. Well, maybe. So they account for, I think, 30 to 40% of traffic now on the web, which is kind of crazy. I consider it passive traffic because you're just sitting there watching a video. But they're essentially the ones that are spearheading the EME spec through because they don't want to use Flash or Silverlight anymore because those things aren't being very well maintained by their respective owners because they're very old and nobody else is using them, right? So hopefully in the future we're going to get rid of these two things for good. Unfortunately, it means that us as developers have to be okay with getting a little dirty with our standards. So what it'll look like for us is before, you know, before the plugin ecosystem was, you could basically do whatever you want. Afterwards, there's gonna be a little bit more hidden from us as far as the way that the you can interface, especially with proprietary content, and you're gonna have to do a little bit more on your part if you want to essentially make sure that you've got encrypted media being passed through the video element. So it's going to be a little bit more hidden. But yeah, so the future is, I've pretty much went over 5 minutes. The future of video is, if you guys want to take something away from this this talk, is the encrypted media extensions, the encrypted media extensions that I quickly just jumped over, we're going to have to get used to those really fast. So look at the specs. They're still being worked on. But immersive interactive experiences, the stuff that I showed you, the cool demos, I want you guys to go away and be like, oh, I want to do something like that crazy music video of Pharrell, man. I need to know somebody like that. Where's my rappers, man? Where's my suite? And then, of course, a JavaScript video codec, which would free us from, you know, all these old school proprietary like music industries and people that hold on to algorithms and patents close to their heart. So that's the future of video online, and I thank you for sitting around. Yeah.